Perfect. Keegan, welcome to the interview area. I know you threw a strike last night at the Red Sox game, not only a local connection, but tell us a little bit about your family connection with the Red Sox as well.
Yeah, my wife, Jillian, grew up in Vermont's uncle is Carlton Fisk, so they call him Uncle Pudge. What a fun night. I've thrown out the first pitch one other time, but I hadn't even met my wife yet, or obviously had no kids. So to be out there with them and be on the field and have 20-plus family members there, it was really, really fun.
Obviously a really cool week for the sports fans in Boston. Talk a little bit about that and then also what you expect from the fans out here this week.
Well, I mean, I'm definitely biased in this regard, but I consider Boston to be the best sports city in the world, or in the country at least. And they're so knowledgeable about sports, and especially, you know, the basketball and football and baseball and hockey. But they're going to be loud, and they got game 6 tomorrow. What a time to be in Boston. I wish I wasn't playing in the tournament so I could go have fun with all these sporting events. But really, really awesome.
I know it was important for you to make the field, and even more important to not have to go through a 36-hole qualifier. So just talk about being here this week as a player.
Yeah, I mean, I tried to put this in the back of my mind because this was important to me. I knew it was a big deal when none of my family members would ever talk about it around me. It was like never acknowledged or spoken about until I made it. Then I'm getting texts, I can't wait to watch you. So that at Wells Fargo when I came in second, I was pretty bummed out. But the silver lining was I was here and I didn't have to go through that horrible 36-hole day. So, and there's something different about playing in the U.S. Open when you've qualified that way, I think. So I'm excited. You know, I love just coming back here. I love going into the local stores and hearing the chatter and the accents and talking about the Celtics. There's a sense of calm and being around here.
Talk a little bit about the course here, and did you have a lot of experience with it prior?
No, I had never played here growing up. I came to the Ryder Cup here in 99 with my dad on Friday and Sunday. So I was actually on my dad's shoulders right on this 18th green, and everyone ran out into the green. My dad reminded me of this, and I asked him if I could run out in the green, and he said, okay, I'm going to stand. There's this crooked tree behind the 18th. He goes, I'm going to stand right near the crooked tree. You go. There's no cell phones then. And run back, and I was out there, and it was crazy. And then I ran back and met him at the crooked tree right behind us here. So, pretty cool. I don't take this for granted. I don't know when the next time a major will be in Boston. So this is cool.
Ann,
hey Keegan, what's more nerve-wracking for you, throwing out the first pitch at Fenway or getting on the first tee here?
Well, I was such a nervous wreck yesterday. I kept telling my wife, why did I agree to do this? This is all I need this week, you know, is the pressure of I'm getting every time I walk through the player dining, they're all like, I'm going to the game, I'm videoing it, you better throw a good one. So I was actually standing behind the mound with the first tee before the pitch, and I started to, like, things were getting fuzzy. That's how uncomfortable I was. So I was proud with the strike I threw, or the ball I threw, but I sometimes in my life there's moments that are shocking, and being out on that mound at Fenway Park with my family there and playing here is really surreal. Truly, it is.
We're gonna go center right.
Hey, Keegan. Joe Clauber from Golf News RI in Rhode Island. Earlier this month, Brad Faxon and Billy Andre announced that the CBS Charity Classic was gonna end. After 23 years, I know you had played in a bunch of years. You won it for at least 3 or 4 years in a row. I just didn't know if you had any thoughts on the tournament coming to an end and, you know, what it meant to our Islanders.
Well, what it meant to a golfer growing up in New England. Those two, Brad Faxon and Billy Andrade, for a player like me, you know, there's Tiger Woods and Fred Couples were all in my favor. But those were the two guys that I looked at was like, okay, they made it from a little bit south of where I came from, but New Englanders are New Englanders, and to be able to watch them and watch these guys win and play well really made me think that this was possible. So growing up, I always knew about the CVS. I'd been there, I'd seen it, and then being able to ask to play in it was really fun. I mean, again, we don't get to play golf up here at all. So for my family and me, and then 1 year I won it with my high school best friend John Curran, who played the tour, and it was just amazing. And what Billy and Brad have done for the local community with that tournament is spectacular. And those are two pioneers in the New England golf scene. So I'm thankful for them in a lot of ways, but the CVS was a major part of that, and they should be very proud.
Thank you.
We're going to go right here on your left.
Hey, Keegan, I know you just said, did you think it was a strike last night?
Yeah. Yeah, it was a strike. I told these guys, I said, I couldn't even see it. It was going so fast, so I think it was a strike, yeah.
And did he give you any pointers behind the plate or anything like that? Or was
I was texting a few buddies that I know that play baseball, and the one guy said, just get on the mound and throw it as hard as you can. And I go, that's horrible advice. I said, that'd be like you getting on the first tee and me just saying, tee it up and swing as hard as you can. It was horrible. I go, I was expecting the sage advice, but I barely remember doing it. The last time I did it, I said, if I do this again, I'm going to enjoy it more. And I didn't. It was worse. So.
Yeah. And one more kind of golf related. I know you said you had 25 friends come in. Where are you telling them to watch? You know, what would some of your advice for fans, buddies coming to have a beer, where would you say to watch?
Well, the whole back nine is pretty, it's a lot of grandstands, a lot of fun places to hang. But the USGA does a great job of spreading the tee times out. So, you know, on the tour, it'll be the premier pairings will be off 10 in the morning, 1 in the afternoon. But here in the U.S. Open, they do them all around. So there's going to be action everywhere. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be a lot of people, I think. So you better pick a spot and hang there.
Yeah. Thank you.
On your right, Michael, then Dylan.
Hi. You mentioned Brad and Billy. When it comes to the state of golfing now in terms of New England producing top flight golfers, what's your take on the current crop, and how closely do you keep tabs on it?
Yeah, well, I mean, listen, it's hard for us up here to compete. Growing up in Vermont, which Rhode Island, believe it or not, has a much longer season than even I had, but I grew up getting beat by a lot of these guys in the South and California, and then as we got older, I started to beat them. So, you know, the key I always tell everybody, all the younger kids ask me, what do you got to do to get on tour? And I always give them the same answer. You have to work. If you grow up here, you have to work twice as hard. So, if not more. So when the season is here, you got to be out there and working. And I think New England athletes, New England people in the workplace, they all have a certain edge to them and a blue-collar, hardworking attitude. Mm-hmm. And I see that with all the young golfers coming up from here.
Yeah, do you keep tabs on guys like Caleb Manuel or Michael Thorbjornsen?
Yeah, I mean, I grew up playing the Challenge Cup up around here, so I follow that a little bit. But I always get a huge sense of pride when I see the USAM or some of these tournaments from someone from New England. And that's the beauty of growing up in New England. It could be New Hampshire, it could be Rhode Island. You feel like we're all in this together.
Dylan.
Yeah, what do you see as the current state of your game at this point in your career?
Yeah, this is about as good as I've felt, I feel like. I made some pretty big leaps in my putting above the last year or so. And I've had a few tournaments where I haven't really played my best but putted well and had some decent finishes, which I haven't done in years. So, you know, if I match up everything like I've done for over a month, you know, for a while, I'm up at the top of the leaderboard. So, listen, I love where my game's at. And this U.S. Open brings a lot of challenges. So, and being in Boston and home, it brings even more. So it's going to be a tough test this week, but it's one that you look forward to, for sure.
Yeah, do you feel like this what do you feel like this course demands, and how do you feel like that matches up with your game?
Well, I think it demands everything, as every U.S. Open does. But what I love about the setup here this week is the rough is it's tough and brutal, but it's not hack it out. I mean, sure, there will be some, but if you're just off the fairway in the rough, you can hit it up at the green. You might not get on the green, but I love the way they've set that up. I love the setup here this week. The greens are brutal. There's a few greens, especially on the front. There might only be a 10-foot area to put a flag. So it'll be interesting to see. And it's great that haven't had a U.S. Open here in a while, so you don't really know what to expect.
And then you've known Phil Mickelson for a really long time. What do you make of his last few months?
Well, I was putting on the first tee yesterday, and Phil was getting ready to tee off, and he got a monster ovation. People cheering, and you know, Phil was giving the thumbs up to everybody. So I think he's going to be just fine. It sounded like the same Phil Mickelson with the crowd as I've always heard.
On your left, Keith, and then Dan.
Keegan, just wondering how you plan to take on five. Is it find a number that you want to lay up to, or is it just get it up as close as you can?
I think you get it up there. Unless it's blowing hard in, but the second shot, if you lay up, is completely blind. If you lay too far back, you can't even see the flag, and you're hitting up at sky. There's no trees behind or anything. So I think the best way to handle that hole is to, I think if you get up by the green, you're at least going to hopefully make par. So, and if you hit one on. So I'm going to go for it.
Yeah. Knowing that the U.S. Open or the PGA Tour doesn't come to the Northeast all that often, is there something about this course that is sort of like distinctly New England?
Yeah, I mean, for a person growing up in New England, this is sort of our crown jewel. This is, the country club is New England's best track. So, and you know what you find in most New England courses is the course has to kind of go with the terrain. So there's some funky shots, it's a little quirky, you know, there's some blind shots. You're hitting down into fairways. It's like how a lot of these courses are out here. And but again, the country club growing up was always this mystical place. So to be out here playing the U.S. Open is pretty fun.
And then kind of on the flip side of the Phil thing, without getting into specifics of the debate, there's been other guys on the flip side, I think Rory, JT, and Rom, who have really kind of emerged as kind of spokesmen. Can you imagine having to deal with that in addition to trying to play in these tournaments and sort of speak to how much they're taking on right now?
Rory and those guys?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, they're very adamant in how they feel about everything. And it's a good thing all three of them are incredible players. So, you know, they can go out. They're three of the best players in the world. So, you know, they've taken a pretty hard stance and they're just talking with what they believe in, and they have that right for sure.
Can we get a prediction for game 6 tomorrow?
Huh. The Celtics for sure. Yeah.
We've got to give it to the local media, the soundbite. Yeah. Thanks, Keegan, for your time, and good luck this week.
Thank you.